Hello everyone, welcome to today's session. This is day two of Learn C++. I hope you all are doing great. Guys, if you have any doubt, you can ask your doubt in the comment section. We are starting in one more minute. Okay, so hello everyone. Please comment your doubt if anyone have any doubt regarding yesterday's lecture. Okay, so I hope we are good to go, Shatej. Shatej, okay. Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, Shatej.
Okay. So let us start with today's session.
Sure, Shatej, I think your voice is breaking. Can
is it audible now?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. So let us start with today's session. So सबसे पहले तो आज हम जैसे कई लोगों को डाउट थे कि हेलो वर्ल्ड का प्रोग्राम थोड़ा जल्दी जल्दी में आ गया था, सो लेट अस रिवाइज द हेलो वर्ल्ड प्रोग्राम एंड देन कवर द फ्यूचर टॉपिक्स एज वेल। तो सबसे पहले एक बार स्टार्टिंग से देखते हैं हैशटैग इंक्लूड IO3। एक बार चैट सेक्शन में कैन यू ऑल कंफर्म इफ द स्क्रीन इज क्लियरली विजिबल एंड द फॉन्ट इज विजिबल और नॉट। Vishwam, can you confirm if the screen, if the code is clearly visible?
It is visible.
Yeah, screen is totally visible.
So first of all, we have included the IOStream library.
Sir, just zoom into the screen a bit.
Just zoomed in, I think.
Okay. Yeah, like everyone is requesting to zoom in a bit. It's okay.
Okay, I am zooming in a little bit. Now I think it will be clearly visible. And
yeah, cool.
IOStream is a library which has the all of the functions which are predefined in the C++. So we need not to define, we need not to write C++ from the starting itself, as C++ works with machine language and machine code. So we need not to define the C++ entirely. So we will include the IOStream library. Now let us come into IOStream library. What is the IOStream? I here stand for input and O stand for output, and stream is the stream. There are two of the different streams. One is input stream, which is for taking the input of the data, and another one is output stream, which is for giving the output of the data. So we are working with IOStream library for functionality of both input as well as output. Then we write a line using name std. So what are namespaces? We will explain to you in great depth when the topic of namespace comes, but till then please understand that namespace is a place where all of our predefined functions are defined. So we are using a namespace. Then int main. So main is the function which runs by default when we start a program. So we are defining a main function and we are returning zero. So what does the return zero here signify? Here the return zero signifies that our program has completed and it has returned zero. If a program, for example, it contains n line of code, and if a program stops in between here, so it will not return zero, and our compiler will get to know that the program is not finished at the till the end, and it is stopped somewhere in between. So return zero signifies that our program is completely successful and is completely run. Now let us see cout. What is cout here? Cout is used is character out. Cout is character out, and a character can be anything. So we are just printing out the character on our screen. So I am saying hello from dot question mark, and we need to terminate a line by using a semicolon. Semicolons mark the end of a line. So when we write a semicolon, our computer gets to know that this is the end of the line. It's as it is written in grammar. For example, in English we have full stop. So semicolon is like a full stop of our C++ programming language. Now coming to the compiling of the code, some of you have problem with the terminal. So first of all, how to open the terminal? Just go to the bottom and expand it up. So a PowerShell terminal will be open. Now how to run the code? first of all, let us see where our code is. It is in the day one folder. So we have to move to the day one folder. The cd command will get you moved to the day one folder, and my fellow Divyasam will explain it. So we will go to the day one folder, and now we will compile the code. G++ is the command to compile the code, and we will write the file name. Now the code will be compiled and it will be stored in the output file. And wait for it to compile. It is a bit slow. Divyasam, can you show the compiling of the code? I think I am facing some of the issues with the... okay, the file is compiled and we have got a file a.exe here. And then we can run the file using .a.exe. And as soon as we press enter, our code will be run and we will get a message hello from .mark. So the cout is not only limited to printing a message. We can also print various of the other things like numbers. For example, I want to print a number. I can also write a number as well here. And we can print anything on the screen using cout. Cout will help you to print anything on the screen. Now, let us get to know something about variables and how you can store data. So, Divyasam, you can share your screen and can tell them about the data thing and variables as well.
Sure. Thank you. So, hello, everyone. I hope my screen is visible and I'm audible. Can someone give me a quick confirmation that I'm audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, thank you. So this is where we left yesterday. We discussed about identifiers, we discussed about keywords. And I saw some people are facing doubt in installation. So for a temporary, as a temporary method, I'm going to tell you a way to just use online compilation for now. It's temporary. I will not recommend do that because every time your code will be lost once you, you know, exit this terminal. So as a temporary fix, I'll suggest you just go to this website that I'm adding here in the chat section. And if only for those whose compiler is not working, and you can code your life on the website. So now coming back to the topic, identifiers and keywords. This is where we left yesterday. I guess sabko yaad hoga, identifiers are, you know, the names given to any variable, function or structure, and that is how you call them. You know, yesterday we discussed about when you want to call your friend Ram, who lives, you know, somewhere close to your house in your city. You don't, you know, call him by that person who lives in that house in that city. You call him by his name Ram. Ram is the identifier. And then there is, yeah, online GDB can definitely save the code, but you can only download it. And next time you have to upload it back again, or you can link your GitHub profile. Coming back to the topic, there are keywords. Now keywords are reserved words, jiski kuch special meaning hoti hai, right? Yesterday we discussed what is special meaning in terms of our own language, Hindi. For example, if you're talking in Hindi to someone, what can be the identifiers? Un logon ka naam ho sakta, jisse aap baat kar rahe ho. And so there are some keywords जिसके कुछ special meaning होते हैं, जैसे you know तुम किसी को बोलते हो यहाँ पे लेट जा, यहाँ पे बैठ जा, यहाँ खड़ा हो जा. These words, लेटना, खड़ा होना, बैठना, these are reserved words. तुम्हें आपको इसकी meaning पता है, ये किसी का नाम नहीं हो सकता. So similarly, these words, even the compiler, the C++ compiler has certain words for which it has special meanings, and these words are called keywords, and they cannot be used as identifiers. So this was a quick recap about where we left yesterday, and I hope everyone is on the same page, and we are starting with today's session, right? From here, as Shethis has said, you need to use compiler to compile your code, and there are some basics about it that I'll show you while coding. Let's start with today's first topic, variables. So what is a variable? You know, yesterday we used many different kinds of values. Humne integer values use kari, humne har type ka values use kara, you know, jaise, I'll just open up the code that we wrote yesterday, right? I'll go to VS code. So this was the code that we wrote yesterday. And here you can see we used you know, some comments and some values. Okay, sorry about that. I had a glitch. Yeah. So yesterday we discussed about this code. जब हम directly value लिख रहे थे and it was getting printed. But do you think this method is feasible? Yeah, surely I'll zoom in. Thank you for reminding. I hope my code is visible. So this is the code that we wrote yesterday, right? We had this, a string that we printed and we directly printed it. Do you think this method is recommended? तुम्हें हर बार कुछ भी print करनी होगी, तुम्हें actually लिखना पड़ेगा वो पूरी value and then you use it. But what if I want to do this again? I want to show this value again. Extra work हो रहा है, right? Extra work हो रहा है. And we don't want to do that. In computer science, if you are doing the same thing again and again, then you are doing it wrong. There is always a better method to do it because in computer science, there is an acronym called DRY, D-R-Y, do not repeat yourself. So keeping this concept in mind कि अपने आप को repeat नहीं करना और same चीज को बार बार use भी करनी है, हमें same value को multiple times use करना है. Here comes variables. That is why variables are necessary. What are variables? Variables are like, you know, they are a name given to a particular memory. जब आपकी C++ program execute हो रही है, वो आपकी मेमोरी में कहीं पे स्टोर्ड है. दैट पर्टिकुलर वैल्यू इज स्टोर्ड समवेयर, बट यू नो यू डोंट वांट टू कॉल इट बाय गिविंग इट्स एड्रेस. आप उस मेमोरी की एड्रेस के थ्रू से कॉल नहीं करोगे. यू विल कॉल इट थ्रू इट्स नेम एंड दैट नेम इज कॉल्ड द वेरिएबल और आइडेंटिफायर ऑफ द वेरिएबल. नाउ द सिंटैक्स, दिस इज इंपॉर्टेंट. दिस इज व्हाट विल हेल्प यू कोड. सो यू हैव अ सिंटैक्स हियर. द सिंटैक्स फॉर डिक्लेयरिंग अ वेरिएबल इज डेटा टाइप स्पेस वेरिएबल नेम space value. So let's do that. Let's declare a variable. I'll create a new directory. So to create a new directory, just go to the left, this section, the file section. From here, just right click and say new folder. I'll call it day two. And right click on day two and say new file. I'll call it, let's say, variables.cpp. You're free to give any name you want. I've just given variables because it's quite relevant here, right? So I'll import the libraries that are necessary. Quickly drop in the comment, guys, of which library do I first need to import? We used it yesterday. IOStream. Cool. We need IOStream to display our value to the users. And another use of IOStream is also to accept values. We'll discuss that. Exactly. Good going, guys. I love the response. I love the way you guys are responding. And the next thing that we need to do is say that we are going to use the namespace std, jiske andar hamari, IOStream ki values defined hai. Or you know what happens otherwise? Error aayegi ki this identifier is not discovered, declared already. So using namespace std, I'll create int main void, the most basic part of C++, the most basic part that has to be there in your C++ code to execute it. So itna maine likh diya. Now what I will do is I want to declare a variable. So to declare a variable, the syntax is I have to use data type space variable name is equal to value. So let's do that. Let's give it a data type. Now let's say mujhe ek integer value store karni hai. Integer value can be anything, any integer value, like any number which does not have a decimal point. So what I'll say is int. Int is the keyword. Int is a keyword which allows you to tell the compiler that is variable mein integer value aane wali hai. So I'll say int my secret variable, my secret var is equal to 7. So see, I followed a syntax. I declared data type. I gave it a name. This is totally up to you. You can give any name you want. Now the rules are simple. The variable name should begin with a letter, an alphabet, or it can begin with an underscore. Only these are the only two things allowed. Either it should begin with an alphabet or an underscore. You cannot begin a variable name with a number. See, instantly there is an error. So I cannot do that. And you cannot include any special character in your variable name. that is also an error. You can only include underscore and no other special characters are allowed, not even white space. You cannot give a white space in between your variable name. So that those are few rules jo aapko yaad honi chahiye while declaring a variable. And yeah, guys, I will definitely look into your message. Once we complete this simple variable topic, I'll take your doubts, right? So int my secret var is equal to 7. I declared a variable just like that. And now let's actually see whether this value 7 is stored in secret var. और अगर आपको इसमें डाउट है कि मैंने यहाँ पे इक्वल टू साइन क्यों दी है, बेसिकली आप इक्वल टू साइन का ऐसे मतलब रख सकते हो कि दिस इक्वल टू साइन ट्रांसफर्स द वैल्यू ऑन इट्स राइट हैंड साइड इनटू द वेरिएबल ऑन इट्स लेफ्ट हैंड साइड. एज सिंपल एज दैट. राइट हैंड साइड इज ट्रांसफर टू लेफ्ट हैंड साइड. सो माई सीक्रेट वायर में 7 की वैल्यू स्टोर हो जाएगी. नाउ व्हाट इज एक्चुअली हैपनिंग हियर, इस कंप्यूटर पे एक कहीं पे मेमोरी एड्रेस है, वेरी कॉम्प्लेक्स मेमोरी एड्रेस जैसे कंप्यूटर में होता है. उस एड्रेस को एक नाम दे दिया गया है माई सीक्रेट वायर. एंड वहाँ पे जो भी चेंजेस होगी वो इस माई सीक्रेट वायर में वो वैल्यू स्टोर्ड रहेगा. एंड करेंटली हमने उस एड्रेस पे 7 डाला. सो लेट्स सी इफ एक्चुअली 7 एग्जिस्ट देयर. टू डू दैट आई सिंपली सी आउट करूंगा एंड आई विल राइट माई सीक्रेट वायर. सो व्हाट दिस विल डू इज नाउ इंस्टेड ऑफ, जैसे याद है हमने लास्ट टाइम क्या करा था, आई जस्ट कॉपी पेस्ट दिस कोड फॉर यू गाइस. कंट्रोल सी. And this is what we did last time, right? This is what we did last time. In after cout, we gave it a complete value that we wanted to print. But abhi, we want to do that in a very quick way. I don't want to write my entire message again. Rather, main sirf variable ka naam likhunga, and isme jo bhi value hogi, wo display ho jayegi. So let's run this code. Now again, I hope you remember the shortcut. It is CTRL plus tilde to invoke the terminal within your VS Code. So welcome to the terminal. It's powered by electromagnetic cheese and let's do something. The basic commands that you will need to navigate through the file structure are these, are something like these. First of all, there is a command called ls. Now I'll just take 2 minutes to describe you terminal commands, because yesterday people were not accustomed to the terminal command line interface. So I'll give you some basics. There is a command called ls. Ls is actually short for list. So ls command kya karta hai, wherever you are, it will write out or display all the files present in this folder. So I'll write ls. You can see ls may be are at day 1, day 2, my directory, because I am here in my the root of my folder. There are 3 folders, you can see day 1, day 2, my directory, and here 3 folder names are displayed. So let's say once you write ls, you can see what folders are present. Okay guys, just a quick note, if you are on Windows, you have to write dir. Dir will show you all the files present in your Windows terminal. I guess ls does not work there in the PowerShell. I'm not sure, just check it out. I've not used Windows for a while. So cool, we are on ls and we saw 3 folders hain, and humme isme se day 2 mein jana, because that is where our current code is, variables.cpp. Now the way you do that is you write cd. Cd stands for change directory. So I will write change directory and I will write the name of the folder into which I want to go. So I am here, I am inside day 2. You can see on the prompt it is telling I am inside learncpp/day2. So I am in the folder ke andar aa gaya hu. And if I now write ls, you can see the name of the contents that are present inside this folder, and it is variable c, of course. We have just saved it, right? So a dir for dir stands for directory means folder. And coming back to compilation, now we need to compile the file. So the way we compile that is we need to call the compiler. We discussed yesterday compiler translate the code into machine code, and the compiler that we are going to use today is g++. And I hope all of us have installed it. If you have not, online compiler hai, usko bhi use kar lenge, no problem if you haven't. So after G++, you need to write the name of the source code jo aapne likha hai, which needs to be converted into machine code. So the name of the source code is of course variables.cpp, because that is what we have written right now. So I'll say variables.cpp and I'll hit enter. And the moment I do that, you can see ek nayi file aa gayi jiska naam hai a.out. It is the compiled binary. If I click on a dot out, you'll see my machine cannot display it because it is not human readable format. It is in binary, right? So you cannot read a binary file. It is not for human readable purpose. It is for the machine purpose. Now, if you want to execute it, you need to call it. The way you do that is you say dot french slash. Dot means current directory mein ye file present hai. ठीक है, अगर कहीं और होता तो मैं किसी और का एड्रेस लिखता. अगर ये यहाँ पे किसी और फोल्डर के अंदर होता मैं लिखता डॉट स्लैश फोल्डर स्लैश फाइल का नाम लिखता, बट सिंस ये यहीं पे मैं सिर्फ डॉट लिखूंगा. डॉट मींस करंट डायरेक्टरी से फाइल उठा लो एंड ए डॉट आउट बिकॉज दैट इज द नेम ऑफ माई फाइल एंड आई हिट एंटर एंड यू कैन क्लियरली सी 7 इज प्रेजेंट. सो जस्ट लाइक दैट वी क्रिएटेड अ वेरिएबल, वी क्रिएटेड एन इंटीजर वेरिएबल and we stored it, we compiled the code and we executed it and it output is present. So with that being said, I'll introduce you to another basic syntax of C++, but before that, some doubts. How to link compiler with IDE from scratch? Okay guys, don't try to link your compiler with IDE from scratch now. I'll show you a workaround. Main kya karta hu, main tumhe online compiler pe dikha deta hu, right? So I dropped the link for online compiler in the chat. I'll do that again. Don't worry about attendance guys, aapke sath form share ho jayegi. 9 o'clock tak aap attendance le sakte ho wahan pe after answering the questions. So just guys, I just dropped a link in YouTube chat, live chat. Just open up that link only for those jinka compiler work nahi kar raha. What you can do is the moment you open that link, you will see this website. I'll just copy it again. Where's the link? Yeah. So this is what you will see when you open the link. This is an online compiler. Here you don't need to worry about kahan pe compiler stored hai, execute kaise karna hai. Isme sab kuch pehle se sorted hai. Everything is already installed here. What I'll do is I'll copy paste the same code I've written. So this is the code that we wrote. यहाँ पे कोई शॉर्टकट्स नहीं वर्क करते. दिस इज फॉर यू नो टेस्टिंग आउट योर कोड. सो आई जस्ट दिस इज द सेम कोड अगेन. एंड व्हाट आई विल डू इज आई विल हिट रन हियर एंड द मोमेंट आई हिट रन आपको आउटपुट यहाँ पे दिख जाएगी नीचे. ठीक है, सो दैट इज हाउ यू कैन टेस्ट योर ऑनलाइन कोड फॉर नाउ. एंड इफ यू वॉन्ट टू सेव द कोड यू कैन हिट द डाउनलोड बटन राइट हियर. सो विद दैट बींग सेट आई विल कम बैक टू वीएस कोड एंड आई इंट्रोड्यूस यू टू अनदर टॉपिक कॉल्ड operators. So I'll create a new file for that. I'll call it arithmetic.cpp. Okay. Again, importing the libraries. And with that being done, I'll include iostream. I'll use a namespace. Okay, that was not needed. Namespace std. And then again a blank main function, right? Okay, so what we need to do now here is we want to let's say हमारे पास variables आ गए. हमारे पास ऐसे तीन चार values हैं, ठीक है, in different variables. And now what if we want to do some operation on it? अभी हमारे पास सिर्फ वेरिएबल्स हैं. कूल, राइट नाउ वी ओनली हैव सम वेरिएबल्स. वी वांट टू डू सम कैलकुलेशंस विद इट, क्योंकि यू नो अगर कंप्यूटर में ये सब काम करता तो कोई मतलब नहीं है कोड लिखने का, राइट? हमें भी पता, हम याद भी कर सकते हैं. चलो एक वेरिएबल है माई सीक्रेट वायर, इसमें 7 की वैल्यू आ गई, बट इसका यूज क्या है, इसको कैसे यूज कर सकते हैं? बिकॉज नाउ यू नो ड्यूरिंग द पीपीटी आई जस्ट सेड कि वी आर राइटिंग स्टोरिंग द वैल्यूज इन वेरिएबल्स टू actually to be able to use them in calculations to actually display those values. So let's do some basic calculations on it. So for that, I'll use arithmetic operators. Okay, so I'll use some basics of arithmetic operators. We'll discuss this first line here. Arithmetic operators, there are different types: addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and modulo division. So I'll just quickly give you a demonstration of these types. What I'll do here is I'll copy these two lines so that So I have two variables, my secret var. I'll reduce the name. MySec2. What I do here now is I'll show you how to do addition in your code. So the way you do that is you can declare another variable int addition. कोई भी नाम दे सकते हो. I want to call it sum. Int sum is equal to MySec1 plus MySec2. As simple as that. I just did addition. Cool. So I'll copy this and ek cheez change karunga. I'll call it difference. Okay, and something you noticed here, maine bhi naam change kiya. And the reason I do that is you cannot give the same name to different variables. If you want to store different values, you have to give different variable names. And I'll do that a few more times. What I'll do is I'll call them product. And the way I do multiplication is I have to use asterisk operator. Then you can do division, which for that, actually something needs to be changed here. I'll show division in a while. After Shritesh Bhaiya covers what are data types, I'll show you how to division. Meanwhile, I can show you what is remainder. So let's say aapko division karke remainder nikalna. For example, yahan pe 10 hai and 7 hai. If I divide them, the remainder will be 3. How to calculate that remainder? So the way you do that is you use simple percentage symbol, right? And just like that, you will have a sum. You can calculate product. You can calculate the remainder. You can calculate difference. So very quickly, let's just see if these values are actually being, you know, calculated. I'll say cout and I'll call it sum. Okay, see, this is another way you can display values. साथ में आप एक interactive message दे सकते हो जो user को थोड़ा details बताएगा कि ये जो value print हो रही है, what is it? Why do what is this value? What is it holding? So I will say sum. फिर मैं एक और you know binary separator use करूँगा and I'll write the name of the variable मुझे जिसकी value print करनी है. So I'll just say sum because sum variable में मेरी value stored है. And after that, it is a good practice to write this line word called endl. It stands for end line. End is equal to end line. So basically, kya karega? Print karke next line mein chale jayega. So I'll just copy paste it and I'll say difference. Okay, cool. It is diff. I'll say remainder and I have product. Right, product. Okay, cool. So very quickly, I'll just execute the code. G++ and name of the file is arithmetic.cpp. I'll say .fun/a.out to execute it and you see the value. Sum is 17, difference is -3, remainder is 7. Okay, that is weird. Yeah, okay, remainder is 7 because actually 10, 7 is getting divided by 10. So usme remainder 7 aega. If I just swap these values, it's going to be ulta. And then there is product of 10 and 7, that is 70. So from here, I'll hand it over to Shritesh sir, and he's going to explain you what are data types and some interesting insights.
Okay, so let us start with the data types, where we will cover the basic data types. Now, as Divisom has already instructed you about the int data type. So int is a data type which is used for integer type variable. Similarly, we have char, bool, float, and double. These are the main data types that we are going to cover. We will also work further with user defined and derived data types. So these are the primitive data types. What are primitive data types? The primitive data types are defined in C++ language only, and they are in the base of C++. They are in the base of C++. So ab data type hota kya hai? Now let us see what exactly is data type. Consider example, we have three spaces, like we have this three spaces, and we want to store the single digit number. So we will store the single digit number here. We want to store a 3-digit number, we will store the 3-digit number here. And we want to store a 5-digit number, so we will store the 5-digit number here. So what difference will it make if I use only the 5-digit space and store the single digit number? I can also do that. I can store the single digit number here also. And I can also store the 3-digit number here. But what is the difference that it will make? If I store a 1-digit number in 5-digit number, it will consume 5 times the memory, because the memory will be allotted for 5 digits. So, इसीलिए to save the space, we have different data types. और different data types होने से हमको specifically पता चल जाता है कि हमको कौन सा data type किस चीज के लिए use करना है. तो अब हम अपने data types देखते हैं. हमारे पास ना तीन अलग अलग तरह के primitive data type होते हैं. One is integral, जो हमारे numbers होते हैं, जैसे अपना 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which are non-decimal numbers. Another one is Boolean data type. So, Boolean data type क्या होता है? हमारा 0 या 1, जो हमारा true या false होता है, जो हमारा machine language समझता है. Directly जो data type machine language समझेगा, that will be Boolean data type. अब हम 1, 2, 3, 4 without decimal numbers में तो सब कुछ कर ही नहीं सकते. तो उसके लिए decimal numbers भी होते हैं. अब एक थोड़ा example देखते हैं. मैं अपना video studio code खोलता हूँ. तो अभी हमने data type declare किया, int i is equal to 10. और मैं नीचे लिख रहा हूँ char ch is equal to, हम char को ना सिंगल कोट्स में डिक्लेयर करते हैं, जैसे a कर दिया. पर अब आप बोलेंगे कि वी मैंने थोड़ी देर पहले बताया दैट करेक्टर इज अ इंटीग्रल डेटा टाइप, दैट char इज अ इंटीग्रल डेटा टाइप. फिर मैं char के अंदर a b c d ऐसी वैल्यूज कैसे स्टोर कर पा रहे हैं? सो एज char इज अ इंटीग्रल डेटा टाइप, बट char कैन स्टोर a b c because it stores the ASCII value. Now what is ASCII value? ASCII value represents the character in some of the digits. For example, I am clicking on it and it is A showing me 65. So A is stored as 65 in the backend. If I write something other, like I write small A and I hover it, the small A is stored as 97. So all the characters are integral data types. And all the operation of integral data types can also be performed on character data type as well. The operations which are shown by DivyaSum, like arithmetic operators, plus, minus, multiply, divide, all of the operations can happen with character data type as well. क्योंकि backend पर character तो numbers पे ही काम कर रहे हैं ना. अब बाकी data types देखते हैं. अब bool data type होते हैं. Bool data type क्या सोचता है? True या false? अब bool data type में हम किस तरह की value दे सकते हैं? अब इसके लिए देखते हैं. बूल मैंने लिखा कि बूल एक टाइम वेरिएबल है, इसको मैं या तो वैल्यू दे सकता हूँ ट्रू की, या मैं इसको वैल्यू दे सकता हूँ फॉल्स की. अब एक चीज आपने देखी होगी कि मैंने यहाँ पे जब इसको ट्रू वैल्यू दी, मैंने बूल डिफाइन किया, बट व्हेन आई गिव द फॉल्स वैल्यू, आई डिड नॉट डिफाइन द बूल अगेन. क्यों करते हैं हम ये? एस व्हाई डू वी डू दिस? वी हैव टू डिफाइन द वेरिएबल ओनली वंस, वी हैव टू डिक्लेयर इट. I have declared the variable using this. I can also use a different syntax, like I will use temp only here and I will write bool temp. So now here the variable is declared. Declared means it is declared that temp exists in the memory. And now I am defining the variable that if its value is true or if its value is false. So these are the two of the main things that we need to know about the declaration and definition. Okay, also there was a question that I was using semicolon for ending the line and DivyaSum was using endl for ending the line. Endl is used to print a line on the output that the next line has begun, but semicolon tells the compiler that the line has ended. For endl is for outputting it and semicolon tells the compiler about it. So there is a difference. Now let us print the value of I and cf. C out and let us just see the difference. Like I am printing the value of I and I am using this command only. Now let us print the value. Now see, 10 is here, but if I write handle, and I write multiple handles so that the difference is clear to you. So it does not make a difference to the compiler, but when we print the output, let us see what difference it makes in the output. Now see, I have a line spaces here. These line spaces are because of the handle. What will be the final value of temp? Okay, final value of temp will be false. Let us see this also. Like I am using cout temp here and using cout temp here. So what it will does? First of all, when let us see how a code executes. Our code is start executing from the main function. First of all, what it will do? It will initialize I with A, and it will initialize ch with A, and then it will declare a temp variable. Now it will make the value of temp to true, and it will print true on the screen. But when this line comes, it will change the value of temp from true to false. So it will change the value, and now the value of temp will be false. And for your reference, temp, the true and false are also depicted by 0 and 1. True is also depicted as 1 and false is also depicted as 0 in C++ language. So let us see what output we will get. Now the clear command is for clearing the screen. Let us see the output, what output will we get. Can anyone guess the output? Can anyone guess the output here? Please share your output in the comment section if you can get it. And I will run the program. Now let us see the output. It is showing 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. How, why is it showing 1, 0, 1, 0? Let us see. First of all, int I was 10. So it print, I was printing at 10. First of all, it was printing temp. Here, temp is true, and true stands for 1. So it printed the first one. But afterwards, it printed temp again. Now the temp was false, and false stands for 0. So it printed 0. And now it printed I. At the end, it printed I, and I was 10. Now, some of you were asking how it is in single line. We wanted to be in different lines so it is easily readable. For that, we were only using handle to make our code easily readable. And we are using handle, so its formatting will change and it will be properly clear to everyone. Now, coming to the float data, float decimal data types, we have float and float and double data types. Float stores the decimal value as well. For example, I want to store 3.17. Float a is equal to 3.17. So it will store the decimal value. And the double data type is also storing the decimal value. Then why we need double? Double data type will store more of the decimals and it will store a larger number. Float will store smaller numbers, but double will store larger numbers. For example, it can also store some of the larger number. You can see the range of the float and double as defined. And we will also share notes regarding that. Yes, float store 4 bits and double store 8 bits. That is correct. Now, I think Divisom can explain them further about the data types and data modifiers. Let us compile this code and then proceed further with Divisom session. Now let us print the A and B value as well. Cout A and cout B. No, wait a minute, I think my screen is not visible. Now let us compile the code and see its last output. So see, here the output is in the decimal form only. 3.17 is the output for first, and 1. This is the output for the double, and the no space is given because we have not provided any space. And if we need space, and not handle between them. We can use the string to give a space between them. So we can use different data types using based on the different functionalities. And can you explain bool temp? Okay, let me explain bool once again. Make the screen visible. So what is temp? Bool is the Boolean data type, and it will store only 0 and 1 values. Only 0 and 1. That stands for true and false. For example, if we want to evaluate something, we will store true or false only. So the bool data type is storing true or false value only. This is a Boolean data type. It will be very useful when you get to know about some of the operators which we will be informing you. So let us start further and explain the data and get to know the data modifiers which are present. So over to you, Divyasom.
So hello again. Thank you, Shatishvia, for explaining data types. And now I'll explain you what are data modifiers. So in the doubts, I saw a question that someone is asking, what if you print a variable without initializing it? Well, C++, provides either, now that depends. Sometimes it can be garbage value. Sometimes it can be a, reasonable default value. Now, what do I mean by reasonable default value? It means if an integer has to 0 either, double at 0.0. And we'll learn that in details when we use access specifiers and, even more modifiers like integer, like, external, global. You'll see you can even define initial values of variables even without putting values in them. So stay tuned for that. Now coming to C++ modifier types. So what are modifier types? We just learned about different data types like integer, double, long, all that part. But what if that data type is not, that data type is not sufficing your needs? What if wo data type aapki needs ko theek se complete nahi kar raha? What if you need something else, something more precise? Something that can do hold your data more precisely the way you want, and hence enter into picture C++ modifier types. So what modifier types do are they provide four different keywords: signed, unsigned, long, and short. And the way you use them or integrate them with your data type is during declaration you have to add a modifier, whether it's going to be signed and any one of these four. So let's see what it does and how these these are different from each other. So let's come back to the code, and in the same code I'll comment out the printing lines, and I'll do something interesting. Well, instead of just declaring these variables at simple integers, product, remainder as integers, I'll add some signed and unsigned. But now you will think, what difference will it make? Well, it can now store larger numbers or different range of numbers. You can restrict the range of numbers. And in the comment section, I saw a question. Someone was asking, what is the range of these values? Well, I'll tell you a method. Aapko kabhi bhi range yaad nahi karna padega. You will never have to remember the range of any data type. You will never have to think about what is the range. You can directly calculate in your mind with in very simple calculation, just an addition or subtraction. So let's do that. Here's one fun exercise for you. It'll take 2 minutes to understand what this is. Cool. So here I have a table. Yahan pe aapko value dikh rahi hai. 2 raised to the power 0, 2 raised to the power 1, 2 raised to the power 2, 2 raised to the power 3. आपको क्या करना है? Whichever value के नीचे 1 लिखिए ना, उस value को उस particular 2 की power को add करके sum बताओ मेरे को, ठीक है? आपको यही करना है. So I'll solve the first one for you. These are the value which you have to add if the value in this row is 1. So यहाँ पे 0 है, मैं इसको add नहीं करूँगा. यहाँ पे 0 है, I won't add 2 raised to power 2. यहाँ पे 0 है, I won't add 2 raised to power 1. But यहाँ पे 1 है, so I'll add 2 raised to power 0. So 2 raised to power 0 is 1, right? Anything to the power 0 is 1. Therefore the sum is 1 because हमने सिर्फ एक को add करा. So guys, quickly drop in comment section what will be the value if I solve this. The second one. Cool. 3 and 9. Good going, guys. Good going. I want more answers. Drop more answers and I'll tell you how it is 3. Okay, cool, cool, cool. Thank you for the amazing response. Exactly. And let me tell you what you have just done. You will be very proud of yourself if you know what you have just done. So, one second, I'll go back to the slide. Okay, let me tell you what you have just done. Ye jo number hai na, I'll go into editing mode again. Yeah. So right here, what we have just done is, you know, you just converted a number from binary to decimal, and it is that easy. So what if I give you this number 0011? You don't make any sense of it, right? Iska koi matlab nahi ban raha. But if you then compare it to something like this, a chart right above it, a power of twos, theek hai, starting from right to left, and add it, you are going to convert it into decimal. And aap sabne bhi wahi kara, right? 0011, it converts into 3, and that is the correct answer. Because is 1 ke upar, ye 2 raised to a 0 hai, so I'll add it. 1 plus 1 into 2 raised to a 1, that is again 1 plus 2, 3. So similarly, this question is 1 hai, and so I will include it. So 2 raised to a 3 is 8. Here is 0, so I will include it. Here is 0, I will include it. Here is 1, hai, so I will include it. So 1 plus 8 is 9. And that is how, guys, you convert a binary number into decimal number. It is that easy. And this is how the computer stores a number. So agar aap integer variable mein 9 store karte ho, computer usko 1001 ke tarah dekhega. And maine yahan pe likha tha, maine yahan pe is way mein likha tha, so that this is, you know, pretty clear to you, such so that it will be a small example. But computer works, you know, in bigger chunks of data. So that is why there is this huge table right below it. It has exactly 8 columns. It has exactly 8 columns. And the reason that it has 8, because every byte in computer is 8 bits. Okay? Just remember this term, 1 byte is equal to 8 bits. And now I'll come back to modifiers and what it does. So the first thing that we have here is signed, unsigned, and then long and short. Now before integrating it in our data type, I'll show you one very quick keyword. The name of that keyword is sizeof. Because if you are, you know, modifying a data type, you should know what it is modifying. So right now, let's use the sizeof operator and check what is the size of this sum variable. So what I will do, I'll just say sizeof sum. That easy. It is that easy. And it will print the size of sum variable. I'll add a, you know, message for that. Size of sum in bytes. Cool. I have no idea why I added a double quote again. So let's save the code and run it. So you can see this value is printed. Size of sum in bytes is equal to 4. My bad, I haven't added equal to in between. So you can see the current size of sum variable is 4. And as Shithit sir has already told you, its size of integer is 4 bytes. So now the thing is, I'll write it out here so that it's, you know, really clear to you guys. What I'll do is, you know, its size of integer is equal to 4 bytes. We just saw that. Now we know that one byte is equal to 8 bits. And this is how, you know, interview mein kaafi baar pucha jata hai, sometimes in C++, even in your exams, you will be asked, is data type ka range kya hai? What is the data type, range of this data type or that data type? So don't ever need to remember those complex number. Just use this easy method. What you will do is, jaise aapko pata hai, integer ka size 4 bytes hai, a very simple number to remember, 4. Now what you will do is, you will multiply that bytes. And we already know that one byte is 8 bits. So what I will say, quickly drop in the comment, integer mein kitne bits hoti hain? Agar integer 4 byte ka hai aur 1 byte 8 bits ki hai, to integer ka size kya hota hai in bits? Quickly drop in the comment section. Okay, cool, 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 cool. Thank you for responding. So I hope it is pretty clear to you, right? So size of integer is 32 bits. Now the easiest trick that exists to remember the range of any data type in C++, what you have to do is just raise that number 2 raised to the power 30 2 minus 1, ठीक है, so that is 31. मैंने 32, मेरे को पता है 32 bits integer के पास, so मैं इसमें से एक bit subtract कर दूंगा, ठीक है, एक bit में subtract करूंगा, I'll tell you the reason of that in a bit, but मैं एक bit subtract करूंगा, and guys, that is the range of integer, minus 2 raised to the power 31, to 2 raised to the power 31, minus 1, and I hope it is pretty clear to you. मैं 2 की पावर के साथ raise कर रहा हूँ, because boolean सिर्फ दो ही possible होती है, 0 and 1. So that number raised to the power 31. And the reason यहाँ पे minus 1 हो रही है, is that बीच में एक 0 आता है, right? अगर मैं negative से positive में जा रहा हूँ, बीच में एक 0 आती है. And the reason that यहाँ पे मैंने minus 1 किया, integer के पास 32 bits होती है, and the reason that I have subtracted 1 from it, is one essential concept that will always help you if you know what it does. इस वैल्यू में ये जो पहली वेरिएबल है ना, ये जो फर्स्ट वैल्यू है, द लेफ्ट मोस्ट बिट हियर, इट इज नोन एज द मोस्ट सिग्निफिकेंट बिट, MSB. दिस बिट टेल्स द साइन ऑफ द नंबर. अगर ये वैल्यू 0 है, इट मींस इट इज अ पॉजिटिव नंबर. अगर ये वैल्यू 1 है, इट मींस इट इज अ नेगेटिव नंबर. सो कीप दैट इन माइंड. आपके नंबर के पास जितने भी बिट्स हैं, उसमें से लेफ्ट मोस्ट पहला बिट कभी भी यूज नहीं होता नंबर स्टोर करने के लिए. इट ऑलवेज रिप्रेजेंट्स द साइन ऑफ द नंबर, वेदर पॉजिटिव और नेगेटिव. एंड हेंस दीज डेटा टाइप्स, दीज डेटा मॉडिफायर्स अलाउ अस टू चेंज दैट. सो ये अभी इंट है और इसका साइज है 2 raised to 31, बिकॉज इसका पहला बिट रिजर्व्ड है टू स्टोर द साइन ऑफ द नंबर. एंड इन केस I'll now declare another thing. So what I will say is, I'll say unsigned, remember the syntax, modifier, data type, variable name is equal to value. So I'll do that again, unsigned int. Now I'll say unsigned integer, I'll give it a name, my int is equal to 7. Now it is not going to make any difference. Main aapke liye fir se ye is line ko print kar deta hu, right? I'll print this line again. Size of my int. Cool, size of my int. And yeah, you know, to make it a little bit fancy, I'll add a p. So if I run the code now, you can see initially sum which was an integer value, iska bhi size 4 tha, and unsigned value, iska bhi size 4 hi hai. So unsigned and signed, they don't make any difference in terms of the size, but internally iski range abhi badh gayi hai, kyunki integer ke paas 4 bytes hota hai, jisme se ek ye store kar deta hai for storing the sign. Well, unsigned kya karta hai, when you make a number unsigned, wo negative number store nahi kar sakta. You know, if I add right here minus 1, it will create an error. Okay, that's weird because I'm not printing out the value. Okay, it means I will save again. I'll go for that. Okay, somehow it is working, but you can see there is a bit of error here. I'm using a different Linux terminal, so error display nahi ho rahi hai, but there is an error. You see this red question mark pops up. And even in VS Code, you can see there is a result because maine unsigned variable mein negative number store kiya. I hope that makes sense. I hope it is clear what unsigned and signed do. Overall, aapki value ki storage mein koi farak nahi padta. Both of them are 4 bytes. No problem with that. But what they do is internally, just jahan pe wo number store hota hai na, uski first bit abhi signed ke liye reserved nahi rahegi. Now it will, the entire bit, all the available bits will be used to store your number. So what's the need of that? Abhi integer ka jo highest value jo wo store kar sakta hai is 2 raised to 31 minus 1, because last bit is reserved. But for unsigned int, the largest number that it can save is 2 raised to the power 32, because all the 32 bits are available to us right now. And yeah, minus 1. And obviously, as you might have guessed already, iska range change ho jata hai. And since it is unsigned, wo negative number store nahi kar sakta. So ye part hat gaya pura, and ab uska range ho gaya 0 to 2 raised to power 32 minus 1. I hope difference between signed and unsigned is clear to all of you. So now let's move on to the second difference, second type of data modifiers, long and short. So now I won't really take time to explain this because you guys already know what is size of operator and how to check the size of a variable. So sabse pehle main kya karunga, I'll using this syntax again, modifier, data type, variable name. I'll define a new value. Okay, guys, while I do that, can you just give me a quick confirmation if my pace is again high? Because I'm trying to be slow, but just give me a quick confirmation.
So you are completely okay, you can continue with the pace. And if anyone else is facing issues with the pace, they can rewatch the session as the sessions are available live on YouTube and they will be present recorded. Because it will not be able to cover all of the concepts at a very slow pace. So you can watch the recorded session again if someone is facing issues. With this one, you can continue with the same pace.
Okay, thank you, sir. I'll just remove that error because here the red line doesn't look good to see. So with that, okay, why is this error? Expected an expression. Never mind. So use the next data modifier, that is long and short. So the way you do that is, now again the same syntax, modify data type variable name. So I'll say long, my data type is int. I will give it a name, my long is equal to 10. And using that, I'll again print its size. So what I did is basically maine variable pe long modifier use kar diya, and with that being said, main size of ke andar my long ko likhta hu, so that my long ki size print ho jaye, and let's see what is the size. You can see size just doubled. Now it is 8 bytes. Now the size of my long is 8 bytes, and I expect you guys to drop me the largest number that this my long variable can store. You know how to calculate it. You know how to calculate this range of integer. Can you guys calculate the range of my long? Quickly, guys. Main aapko quick shout out dunga. Yeah, definitely it is a wastage of memory. Cool. 8 byte is 64 bit. Now guess what is the range of long? What is the largest number that it can save? Exactly 2 raised to 64, minus 1, because zeros start with the accounting, so minus 1. And guys, it is not 64. Guys, it is not 64. It is 2 raised to 63, because the range is, you know, from unsigned, from the side of unsigned. Like it will be 64 if I define it unsigned as well. I have not defined it, and you can define, nest your modifiers together. I can say unsigned followed by long, and it is totally fine. I'll refresh it and run it again for you guys. Right now it is 8 bytes, but its range of largest number has also changed. And with that being said, I'll hand it off to Shetit sir again. He has some beautiful insights to share with you. And shout out to everyone who gave the correct answer.
Yes, shout out to everyone. Now let us continue further. Ab aapne dekha hoga ki humne data types define kar diye. Now we are storing different variables. We are using the data modifiers. So ab dekhte hain yaar, ab mere ko kya karna hai? Let us see something. Mere ko roll number store karna. So I am using int r1. I cannot use the word roll number because we have to store roll number of 5 different students. So I am using int r1 is equal to 1. Int r2 is equal to 2, and int r3 is equal to 3. So now what is this? We can store this, but now also we want to store the id of something is id and roll number, they are different. So int id1 is equal to 1001. Can you please mute your mic? And int id2 is equal to this, and int id3 is equal to this. So what will happen now? You are confused that when you are using r1, r2 or r3, which value it is signifying, and when you are using id, which value it is signifying, as all of them are int data type. But now we can also create our own defined data type. For that, I can use typedef. And typedef, I can use the typedef, and I can use the int data type. I am defining a type for int data type, and I can say it is roll number. So what it is doing, it is defining my own data type. So I can use roll number data type for these numbers as well. So it will be easy for me to program. And I can use type def int and id. And I can use the id data type for storing these different numbers. So what type def is doing? Type def is creating an alias name for the existing data type. For example, now I am using a roll number instead of int. So why I am using roll number if it is an alias? If roll number and int are same, then why I am using roll number for that? I am using roll number so that I can get to know this R1 is a roll number and this ID1 is an ID. So I can use type def. So type def is a concept where you can give alias to a existing user defined data type and you can create your own data types from it. So type def is making our life easier. But now, what if you want to store some Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, the days of the week? So what we are using? We are using int Monday is equal to 1, int Tuesday is equal to, so let us start with 0, 0, 1, and now we have to define all of the data types, all of the variables. For this, we can use enum. Enum is an enumerated data type which can store the data of our numbers in the integral form. It stores the data from 0 to the end of the number. For example, if I want to store data types like week, I am creating a week and I am using mon, tuesday, wednesday. So what it will do, it will automatically assign 0 to Monday, 1 to Tuesday, and so on. For example, you can also see Monday is equal to 0, Tuesday is equal to 1, Wednesday is equal to 2. So it will assign these things, and I can even use it to print cout week, and I can use the day Monday. So what week Monday will print? Let us see what is the output of week Monday. Any guesses? Enum is like object. No, enum is not like object. Enum gives integral value to our values. We can also use some of the predefined values. For example, I want, let us see this thing and then proceed further with my values also. Let us compile the code and see the output. So it is giving me 0. So Monday stored as 0, Tuesday stored as 1, Wednesday stored as 2. But what if I want my weekdays to start from 1? So I can initialize the value Monday as 1 and it will automatically update the following value as 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So what it will do now, let us see the difference between leaving it by default and initializing it. So now it is giving me Monday as 1. But what if I do not want Thursday? I only want my working days. Like I am only wanting working days. And for example, in my organization, Wednesday and Thursday is a holiday instead of Saturday and Sunday. So now what I will do? Now, if I print Monday, it will be fine because Monday is 1. Tuesday will also print fine, but let us print Friday. So now let us also print and I'll make our output clear. And compile it. So it is 1 and 3, but Friday is not the third day of the week. We want Friday to be the fifth day of the week. So I will initialize Friday as 5, and the following numbers like Saturday and Sunday will automatically be initialized to 6 and 7. So enum is a data type where we can use some of the integral value in the form of some of the predefined values. For example, I am using Monday as 1. Now let us see the difference. When I initialize Friday as 5, I can also let us print everything. Let us also print Tuesday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Let us see the output of this, like how well you are initialized. Yes, Vanshika, you are completely right. It will print 1, 2, 5, 6, and 7. So this is the correct answer. Why it will do so? Anyone can tell that why it will do 1, 2, 5, 6, 7? It will do 1, 2, 5, 6, 7 because 1 and 2 are initialized from this number. But we can use another number to initialize any other variable. If I remove Friday is equal to 5, so it will initialize as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And it will not initialize as 1, 2, 5, 6, 7. So we can use different values and we can use enumerated data type and typedef to make our life easier. Typedef and enum are not used often, but they are used by experienced programmers to make their life easier so that they can understand their code at a later point of time. So I will instruct you to use enumerated and typedef also to make your code simple and easier to understand. Now let us proceed further with some of the operators. And I would like to invite Divyasom further to continue with the operators. Divyasom, are you there?
Yes, present, sir.
Okay,
so coming back to today's session, coming back again to where we left. So as such as I explained, there are different, quick ways to create a custom sequences. And, okay. We discussed about the type modifiers, and this is just a quick glance of how C++, differentiates between different data types. So now you know about all the data types, and you can see then we have character, which is the smallest of 1 byte, then short, which is of 2 bytes, then integer of 4 bytes, long is also of 4 bytes. By default, long is also of 4 bytes alone, but when you use long, it becomes 8 bytes. So yeah, that's the hierarchy. And let's move on to some operators that will actually allow us to take decisions. How will you take decisions? To take a decision, you need to compare different things, and only then you can take a decision, right? Agar aapko decide karna hota hai ki aapke samne do insaan hai, which person is taller, you'll say either the first person is taller or the second, right? And how do you do that? You compare their heights, and height is a value. Comparison is always done on the basis of some numerical value. And to do that in your code, let's learn the relational operator and let's take decisions, okay? Dots of S. Just to show how excited I am to talk about relational operators.
Some of the students have exam tomorrow. So let us continue with the doubts and continue with relational and logical operators and conditions from tomorrow. So guys, if you have any of the doubts, you can ask your doubts. First of all, there is a doubt by Ramanpreet Singh. If Friday is equal to 5, then why next day will be assigned 6, 7? Why not 4, 5? Because enumerated data types automatically skip the number that are left, and that will be skipped only. And there is a doubt, can two variables have same number like Monday is equal to 2 and Tuesday is equal to 2? No, that will result in error.
Guys, when you create enum value, the basic requirement is that the sequence that you're using, it is called the key, and the custom value that you're providing, it is called value. So there is a key and value pair, and the syntax is that key should be unique. It should not repeat. The value may repeat, but key should never repeat. Okay, guys, drop in your questions and we take
all the questions. Yeah. There is a question, store size. What is the size of stored variable?
Okay, the first thing that we need to make clear is that short is not a data type. Short is a, you know, size modifier.
Type modifier,
exactly. So integer is the data type. Long, long is a modifier. Then you have integer, float, double, and you can modify them using short. And when you use short, it is going to, you know, divide it by two, divide the size by two. So as we know, integer size of integer is 4. We saw that in our code. And if you use short int and then declare some variable, then its size is going to be 2 bytes. And as you might have already guessed, its range is going to be between -127 to 127.
And there is a doubt. Can you please explain typedef once again? Okay, so explaining typedef once again, typedef is used to increase the readability of our code. You can also use integer instead of roll number, but using roll number will increase the readability of your code, and it will explain to the user why we are using this roll number, what it is using. And readability is a major concern when it comes to industry level practices and industry standards as well. So typedef and enum are used to increase the readability of our code and to make our code more easily understandable by yourself or some of the other programmer as well. So typedef and enum you can use. Can you elaborate enum? Yes, we can elaborate enum. We will use enum and we will get to know about enum as well in the further sessions, and we will share enum notes as well after the today's session. So no need to worry about that.
Exactly. And guys, if you want to relate to typedef, typedef is quite confusing because you don't exactly understand why you are using that in your code. I will give you a very basic example, jise aapko samajh mein aayega, right? Every one of you here are having a friend circle, theek hai? And let's say your friend has some huge name, or let's say you don't want to give them a nickname. So that the name of your friend, the actual name that he is, let's say that name is Ramesh. So in every group, in, you know, all the people over the world will know him by the Ramesh. But you, when you are with Ramesh, let's say you given him a nickname, and that nickname is Toby. So jab aap uske saath ho, aap usko Topi bulate ho, but the entire world knows him by the name, you know, Ramesh. So you can kind of relate to that. Using typedef, you can do that in your code. You can give nicknames to data types.
Guys, attendance form is in the description. Kindly fill the attendance. Till 9 o'clock, you have the window to fill the attendance. And guys, do attend the sessions live, because if you are attending the sessions live, you can, you know, resolve your doubt over live sessions only. Okay, and if you have any other doubt regarding installation or other part which shows some errors, so do ping the SS in the Telegram on the Telegram group. Our team will be there to help you out. Thank you.
Syntax of all the functions will be available in today's notes. You can refer to today's notes for the syntax of the today's functions. And I think Sarthak has also an announcement to make regarding tomorrow. If Sarthak is there.
Hello everyone, and tomorrow, you know, we will repeat the history. What the history is, we will have a quiz night tomorrow. In this particular quiz night, what we have covered in these 2 or 3 days, we will have a quiz of that particular, you know, segments, and it will be a great fun. All the questions which will be asked by us in the quiz night, you know, have some, you know, are from, you know, from different MNCs. These questions asked by the mentors, those who are in Google, Microsoft, Infosys, Wipro, the HRs of these companies ask these types of questions. Do attend the quiz night as well. We will share the link in the description in your Telegram and WhatsApp group. Today's midnight. Don't forget to fill the attendance form, because guys, it is very important to maintain the record how many of you are coming daily. Okay, thank you.
Also, there is a quiz night tomorrow. Does not mean there is not a class tomorrow. The classes will be from 7 and the quiz night will be at 9 p.m. Sorry, 6 p.m. 6 to 7 will be class, and 9 to 9:30 or 9 to 10 will be the quiz night. And I have pasted the link in the live chat also, as well as it is in the description. So you can fill the attendance form as well.
Quiz night will be on Kahoot. We will share you the Kahoot, what is Kahoot, how you can play. It's a live quiz. We will have, you know, we will have a live quiz on YouTube only. So we will share you about that in your respective group. Don't be panic.
Also, regarding the quiz night, please make sure you have two of the devices. And quiz night will only be there for the live participants. Quiz night will not be there for the inactive participants. So please set up two of the devices. One will be your laptop where you will be doing the questions, and another will be your mobile phone where you will be playing the quiz. So it is requested to set up two of the devices.
Okay, guys, if you have any other doubt, you can ask. There's one doubt. What is the use of scope resolution operator?
Actually, the scope resolution operator is not covered as of now. We will cover it in our further session. So please,
guys, ask it. Okay. Wait, guys.
If you want to, in the first session, if you remember, like you while using cout, when we had not declared the sentence using namespace std, when you have not initially told the compiler that from which namespace hum is values ko use karenge, then you can use namespace, you know, scope resolution operator. You can say cout specifically belongs to std, and to do that, scope resolution operator exists. So stay tuned for that. We'll do that in very depth when we come to object oriented programming.
And guys, please maintain the decorum of the live chat. You are not here to ask some of the personal questions from anyone. Please maintain the decorum and do not ask any of the personal questions, even in the Telegram channel or in the live chat.
And thank you everyone for this lovely session. We are very happy to have you all. Kindly be present daily. Have a faith in us. You will be, you know, coding master in next 14 days. So have some patience, and thank you for attending the sessions. Thank you everyone. We are
the quiz night will be at 9 p.m. tomorrow. The session will be at 6 to 7 p.m. tomorrow.
Okay, there's a doubt why we use scope resolution operator. Well, in this case, as humne iostream library import kari hai, right? So that iostream ki जो डेफिनेशंस है, जो कोड iostream के अंदर है, वो अभी हमारे कोड में है नहीं, हमने उसको सिर्फ इंक्लूड करा है. सो टू एक्चुअली बी एबल टू यूज दैट, वी यू नो स्पेसिफिकली टेल द कंपाइलर कि अगर कोई वेरिएबल की डेफिनेशन नहीं मिल रही है, देन लुक दैट डेफिनेशन इन std namespace जो कि iostream के अंदर है. आई होप दैट मेक्स सेंस टू यू. जस्ट काइंड ऑफ पूछा था, आई गेस.
ओके, दिस इज द एंडिंग.